Hello guys, this is a lecture on the poetry of Thomas Gray. As you know, the coronavirus is spreading everywhere, so we have suspended classes for a couple of days and students are learning from home. So I will video record Thomas Gray lecture and put it on YouTube so that not only my classroom students but everybody can benefit. This is a portrait of Thomas Gray by John Giles Eckhart. You can see a very delicate, rather effeminate man. He was homosexual, and because of all this, he was shy also. Let us take a look at his life. Thomas Gray, 1716 to 1771. He was the best of the transitional poets, a very brilliant man. The second most important poet of the 18th century after Alexander Pope. Despite his great talent, Gray wrote only a small body of poetry. Unfortunately, because of societal pressures, he was shy and he was diffident, and he could write only a small body of poetry, which he published rather reluctantly. He had to be forced to publish as well. There was a reclusiveness and timidity that characterized his whole life. He was not a very smart, confident man. And this was partly due to his frail health and homosexuality, which was at that time considered taboo. Of the many children born to his parents, only Thomas survived infancy. Most of his siblings had died, and he was deeply attached to his mother for this reason. His mother continued to be a great influence on Thomas Gray throughout his life. Gray's education was at the very prestigious Eton College. Eton College was a preparatory school where his uncles were teaching at that time. That is how he got admission there. And Gray formed friendships with the very illustrious Horace Walpole, the son of Robert Walpole, the chief minister, as well as Richard West and Thomas Ashton. Horace Walpole and Richard West were very big influences on Thomas Gray's life and career. Horace Walpole was the architect of the Gothic novel, and he was a son of England's prime minister or chief minister at that time. There was no big distinction between the two. Robert Walpole, he was a Whig minister. Later, Gray entered Peterhouse College at Cambridge University. There are many colleges in Oxford and Cambridge University. And he entered first Peterhouse College and then Pembroke College. Debating whether to join the legal profession, he went on a grand tour to France and Italy with Walpole. Like many young men at that time, Gray and Walpole also went on a grand tour to France and Italy, but returned home with others when the two of them quarreled. Having become financially independent by the death of his father in 1741, Thomas Gray returned to writing. In 1742, Gray sent Richard West his Ode on the Spring, shortly before Richard West's death due to tuberculosis. Gray was at this time translating John Locke's Essay Concerning Human Understanding. Essay Concerning Human Understanding is a philosophical work published in 1690, and it is a very great work of empiricism. Gray, at this time at his mother's house in Stoke Poges, wrote Sonnet on the Death of Richard West. That is a very major poem. Also, Hymn to Adversity, Ode on a Distant Prospect of Eton College, and the unfinished Hymn to Ignorance. Please note these titles. In 1743, Gray graduated in law and became reconciled with Horace Walpole the following year. Remember, they had both quarreled on their grand tour to France and Italy. In 1747, when Walpole's cat died, Gray sent him Ode on the Death of a Favorite Cat Drowned in a Bowl of Goldfishes. That is a mock heroic poem by Thomas Gray. Now, let us take a better look at the three early poems that I already mentioned. Sonnet on the Death of Richard West, which is on the death of his friend. Hymn to Adversity is a Spenserian allegory. Thomas Gray, in his early poetry, showed a Spenserian spirit. And then, Ode on a Distant Prospect of Eton College. It recalls his school days as a time of great happiness. Remember, that is a very important romantic theme. And this poem ends with the lines, "No more where ignorance is bliss, 'tis folly to be wise." Gray is not promoting ignorance here, but reflecting nostalgically on a time when he was allowed to be ignorant. That is his youth. Youth is a time of ignorance, and he is remembering youth. So these are the three early poems. Now, the very famous poem, Thomas Gray's Elegy, written in a country churchyard. Gray became famous for his Elegy written in a country churchyard, published in 1751. Thomas Gray's Elegy written in a country churchyard came in 1751. And it was written in the graveyard of Stoke Poges in Buckinghamshire in 1750. And he had sent it to Horace Walpole after writing it. In 1750, he sent it to Horace Walpole. And then afterwards, he sent it to the publisher. The poem contains the spirit of 18th century sentimentalism. Dr. Johnson praised the elegy, but he was not very appreciative of Gray himself. Dr. Johnson famously said, "In the character of his elegy, I rejoice to concur with the common reader. The churchyard abounds with images which find a mirror in every mind, and with sentiments to which every bosom returns an echo." Remember this. The churchyard abounds with images which find a mirror in every mind, and with sentiments to which every bosom returns an echo. Now, let me give you a summary of the elegy. In the first three stanzas, the poet portrays a picture of nature that is very famous. The curfew tolls the knell of parting day. And the poet draws our attention to the bellowing of the cattle, the ploughman ending his work, and the world is left to darkness and to the poet. The shining landscape is becoming dimmer and dimmer. There is a solemn silence everywhere. And he uses a lot of onomatopoeic expressions here. He talks about the beetle sound, the sound of the bells, the moping owl or the mourning owl. So the poem begins with a description of the countryside. Looking at this churchyard of Stoke Poges, can you imagine that scene? Then, having described the surroundings that is slowly being enveloped in darkness, Gray turns to the graves of the ordinary men, the men, the rustic forefathers lying buried in their graves in the churchyard. You can see such graves here. The graves are beneath the rugged elms under the shade of the yew trees. You don't see a yew tree here, but the yew trees are thick, dark trees with overhanging branches. The graves are noticeable. No, there are no tombstones like this. There are only mold of earth. None of these rustic forefathers will ever rise from these lowly beds where they lie. And they are incapable of responding to the morning breeze or to the birds. The fire in the hearth will never burn for them now. The housewife will not do her work and wait for their return now. No grandchildren will climb their knees now. They are dead and gone. And before they were laid to rest, these rustic forefathers had worked in the fields. And Gray also describes the kind of work that they did. They plowed the hard ground, cut furrows, etc. They drove the oxen on the in the fields, etc. They did very hard toil. And their work was very useful also. However, they did not become famous like the wealthy, ambitious people. Then Gray warns the wealthy, ambitious people not to mock the humble, hard labor of these honest people. The joys of these rustic forefathers was very homely, and their destiny was unknown. And the wealth, the goddess of wealth, did not smile upon them. That doesn't mean there were mean people. There were insignificant people. Then Gray goes on to prophesy on death or philosophize on death. He shows that death makes no distinction between the wealthy and the poor, between the simple and the proud. This is a very important warning that he gives in the poem. Death makes no distinction. Death is the great leveler. Death, before death, we are all equal. This is the very famous expression of memento mori. That means, remember, you will die. Let not ambition mock their useful toil, their homely joys and destiny obscure, nor grandeur hear with the disdainful smile the short and simple annals of the poor. And he says, death is the great leveler. Nothing can save you from death. The inevitable hour will take us all. Everybody has to die. Can storied urn or animated bust back to its mansion called the fleeting breath? Can honor's voice provoke the silent dust or flattery soothe the dull, cold ear of death? He is saying that death is inevitable. And then the poet warns the proud people against finding fault with these poor peasants just because they did not have memorials over their graves or no anthems were sung in their praise. That doesn't mean they were not good enough. Because full many a gem of purest ray serene, the dark unfathomed caves of ocean bear. Full many a flower is born to blush unseen and waste its sweetness on the desert air. That means these poor people might have blossomed into great men if only cold poverty or cold penury had not crushed them or denied them their opportunities. If they had the opportunities, they would have become rulers or scholars or poets. Some village Hamden that with dauntless breast the little tyrant of his fields withstood. Some mute inglorious Milton here may rest, some Cromwell guiltless of his country's blood. There is a little dark element there. These great people are often guilty and heartless. The humble villagers did not achieve great things, neither have they become cruel or heartless. The humble lot of the dead villagers has denied them the applause of the Senate or the glory of martyrdom. But it has also prevented them being very lowly in life, has also prevented them from abusing their power and from becoming tyrants. So their lowly status has kept them away from the maddening crowd. They did not have to take part in the maddening crowd. So far from the madding crowd, that madding means maddening. Far from the madding crowd, that phrase was from this occasion taken by Hardy to name his famous novel. Now, next, Thomas Gray talks about, let me turn the pages of the poetry book. Yeah. So the humble villagers did not have to struggle against the their own conscience. The humble lot of the villagers prevented them from becoming tyrants. Yeah. Now, their names, their years spelt by the unlettered muse. He's looking at these tombs and he says that the rustic moralist has only some very misspelt names and years on his tomb, nothing in the form of epitaph. But that has given him morality. That lack of pomp and splendor in life has given the rustic moralist some goodness. They teach the rustic moralist to die. And then these old people from the villages who have died, they should not be forgotten. They need some memorial. And this song that the poet is composing is a memorial. On some fond breast, the parting soul relies. These dead people rely on some fond breast like this poet. Some pious drops the closing eye requires. Even from the tomb, the voice of nature cries. Even in our ashes, live their wanton fires. We should sing for them. And afterwards, when the poet is also dead, somebody will ask after the poet. We saw one gray-haired man here in these plains, in these hills. What happened to him? He is not seen anymore, somebody will say. And then some hoary-headed swain, some gray-haired old man, some hoary-headed swain will say, yeah, he used to be here, but he was not seen one day. The old rustic will say that the poet whom they saw there was not seen one day, and after a few days, his coffin was seen to be carried away. He is now dead and buried, and he was neither fortunate nor famous. Like that, one day, the poet will also die. I will read those lines. The hoary-headed swain is saying, there at the foot of yonder nodding beech that wreathes its old fantastic roots so high, his listless length at noontide would he stretch and pour upon the brook that babbles by. Hard by yon wood, now smiling as in scorn, muttering his wayward fancies, he would rove. Now drooping, woeful wan, like one forlorn, or crazed with care, or crossed in hopeless love. All these expressions are that of the poet. Sometimes he would smile to himself. Sometimes he will look forlorn. And one morn I missed him on the customed hill. Usually he would be seen on that hill, but one morning I missed him along the heath and near his favorite tree. Another came, another day came, that means. Nor yet beside the rill, nor upon the lawn, nor at the wood was he. Nowhere he was found. The next with dirges due in sad array, the next day dawned, and he could hear dirges. Slow through the churchway path, we saw him borne. We saw his body being carried away. Approach and read the lay, graved on the stone beyond yon aged thorn. After this, at the end of the poem, there is an epitaph for the poet himself. In the epitaph, the poet says, here rests his head upon the lap of earth. The poet did not know fortune or fame, but he deserves an epitaph. So he's writing it. Here rests his head upon the lap of earth, a youth to fortune and to fame unknown. Fair signs frowned not on his humble birth, and melancholy marked him for her own. Large was his bounty and his soul sincere. Heaven did a recompense as largely sent. He gave to mystery all he had a tear. He gained from heaven, 'twas all he wished, a friend. Heaven was his friend. Nobody else was his friend. He did not have anything else in life. No farther seek his merits to disclose. This is the last quatrain. Remember, this is in quatrains. No farther seek his merits to disclose, or draw his frailties from their dread abode. There they alike in trembling hope repose, the bosom of his father and his God. Elegy written in a country churchyard ends with the word God. So, an elegy, a summary of the elegy I have again given here. It begins with a contemplation of the landscape, moves to a consideration of the short and simple annals of the poor. Moral ideas arise from this consideration. And the poet then muses upon human potential and mortality. He presents the prospect of the poet's own death at the end. Art, that means this poem, might offer a durable memorial against time. And deep personal feelings are involved. This is William Blake's illustration of the elegy. William Blake painted all, engraved all this onto metal, including the words, and the whole page was printed with that metal sheet. Gray in the 1750s. Unique in Thomas Gray's oeuvre is a long story, a burlesque tale of magic and intrigue, similar in tone to Coleridge's Christabel. In 1753, Horace Walpole, arranged with Richard Bentley, the son of the famous scholar, satirized in Swift's Battle of the Books to make engravings for 6 poems of Gray. I know you didn't understand what happened. In 1753, Horace Walpole asked his friend Richard Bentley to make engravings for 6 poems of Gray. Now, who is this Richard Bentley? He is Richard Bentley the Junior, the son of another Richard Bentley, a famous scholar who was satirized in Swift's Battle of the Books. The father, Richard Bentley, had made fun of William Temple. The father, Richard Bentley, had made fun of William Temple for supporting the ancients. And Swift attacked Richard Bentley in Battle of the Books. Gray's Pindaric Odes are the progress of poesy and the bard. They were printed by Walpole in his press at Strawberry Hill. When Colley Cibber died in 1757, Gray was offered the post of Poet Laureate, but he declined. When Colley Cibber died in 1757, Gray was offered the post of Poet Laureate, but he declined because he was shy. He wanted to avoid public functions. This is Bentley's engraving for an elegy written in a country churchyard. This is one of the engravings, elegy written in a country churchyard. This is a poor poet. 2 people you can see here near a tomb. Another engraving for a hymn to adversity. Medieval style, William Blake followed. Against the commercialization of the modern style. This is an engraving for Ode on a Distant Prospect of Eton College. Engraving for Ode on the Death of a Favorite Cat. Look at the cat going to jump into a bowl of goldfishes. The Pindaric Odes are the progress of poesy and the bard. The Pindaric Ode, the progress of poesy, was subtitled the Pindaric Ode. The bard is the poem where the speaker is the last survivor of the ancient Celtic bards. The last of the ancient Celtic bards. And he's cursing the Norman King Edward I after his conquest of Wales. Thus, he is censuring tyranny and oppression. The bard prophesies in detail the downfall of the house of Plantagenet. It ends with the bard hurling himself to his death from the top of a mountain. The bard hurls himself to death from the top of a mountain in the bard. In the 1760s, to write a history of English poetry, Gray did 2 years of research at the British Museum and made several tours across England and Scotland. He was attracted by the work of James Macpherson. And James Macpherson had published in 1760 fragments of ancient poetry collected in the Highlands of Scotland. Gray made investigations of his own into the Celtic and Scandinavian past and translated Welsh and Icelandic originals at this time. He was inspired by James Macpherson and he made his own studies and translations. At this time, he wrote 2 Norse odes. Norse is Scandinavian. He wrote 2 Norse odes, The Fatal Sisters and The Descent of Odin. The Norse odes are about Scandinavian legends. They are anticipative of the 2 poets called Scott and Coleridge. Walter Scott and Coleridge were poets who wrote about the medieval and the exotic. In 1762, Gray applied for the post of Professor of Modern History at Cambridge. But the post was given to another man, but that man, Lawrence Brockett, died after a few years in an accident, and Gray got the appointment. But he was too shy and never delivered any public lectures. In his last years, Gray wrote a few poems. He translated from Welsh. First, he translated from Norse and now Welsh. And he wrote some occasional satirical verse. He went on long walking tours to the picturesque districts of England, including the Lake District. His journal of these years, which describes a sublime experience of nature, has influenced the later romantics. The later romantics, in their picturesque appreciation of landscape, was influenced by Gray. Gray died in his rooms in Cambridge of a violent attack of gout. That is what Milton also died of, and he was buried near his mother in Stoke Poges. So a quick look at Thomas Gray's oeuvre. He has written the Pastoral Elegy, Elegy written in a country churchyard. He has written Horatian odes, such as Hymn to Adversity, Ode on the Spring, Ode on a Distant Prospect of Eton College, etc. His Pindaric odes are passionate compared to the calmer and moderate Horatian odes. Remember, Horatian odes are by definition calm. Pindaric odes are by definition passionate. Gray's Pindaric odes are the progress of poesy and the bard. He has also written a mock heroic poem on the death of a favorite cat drowned in a bowl of goldfishes. Ode on the death of a favorite cat drowned in a bowl of goldfishes. He has also written poems on Celtic, Norse and Welsh subjects, such as The Fatal Sisters and The Descent of Odin. Odin is the same as Ossian. James Macpherson wrote Ossianic poems. William Butler Yeats wrote about Oisin. They are all the same character. So Thomas Gray's poetry was strongly marked by the taste for sentiment, controlled by classical ideas of restraint. So sentiment is romantic, classical is neoclassical, Augustine. There is a blend of the romantic and the Augustine. Classical ideals of restraint and composure, but prepared the way for the inward emotional exploration displayed by the romantics. He combined traditional forms and poetic diction with new topics and modes of expression. The classical and the romantic combine in his form also. He almost worshipped Dryden and loved Racine as heartily as Shakespeare. He valued polish and symmetry as highly as the school of Pope, and shared their taste for didactic reflection and for pompous personification. He had some features sharing with Pope, yet he also shared the taste of sensibility, which found expression in the romanticism of the following period. So that is an overview of Thomas Gray. Hope you enjoyed this video. Thank you.